joining us from Fox Business, Charles Payne. First time on the program. Charles, pleasure to have you. Appreciate your work. You were pretty mad about Harvard getting about They ended up getting $9 million from the CARES Act, but they have a $40 billion endowment, and they say they're not giving it back. Charles, your take on this?
First of all, it's an honor to be on the show. Thanks a lot, Dana. I'm incensed about it. I really am. This is just it's beyond the pale. So far Shake Shack, someone at Shake Shack crunched the numbers and said the $10 million we got we're going to lose a lot more than that in respect and potential business. So they gave the money back. And for Harvard to be this thin air and this so detached from what's happening in this country, you know, J.P. Morgan was the one that gave Shake Shack the money. They gave Potbelly the money. They gave Ruth Chris the money. So they gave out. You know, they were a conduit for $14 billion, and they said they have another $26 billion to go. But it's apparent that they went to the biggest folks first, right? Mm-hmm. Including some of these publicly traded companies. And we know that wasn't the essence of what this was about. Forget about the loopholes. We know it was written in haste. This is an emergency.
Right.
You know, people don't always, you know, but we know what this was meant for. Everyone understands that. J.P. Morgan understands it. Harvard understands it. And it's still happening. And it's embarrassing. And it's really heartbreaking.
Yeah, it makes me wonder if there's any kind of mechanism that Congress can use, or I don't know if they thought of that when they were writing this act, that they can use to make Harvard give it back. I mean, when I look at what their endowment is and how much money Harvard actually does have, that's like a drop in the bucket to them. So it just seems like they're just doing it out of spite at this point.
I think you're right. And, you know, here's the first headline when this whole coronavirus really began to rear its ugly head. Harvard had let go of cafeteria workers, their subcontractors, almost 300 workers. If they would have paid them regular wages, they would have cost them $700,000, which is 1% of 1%.
Right.
So they already entered into this arena with just, you know, an embarrassment. Like, go somewhere and hide. If you want to help, take some of the $40 billion that you have. You know, they're really, if you want to think about Harvard, really Harvard is a hedge fund.
Yeah. Oh,
that
yeah.
That does education on the side. It's a hedge fund that does education on the side. And the private jets, the $40 billion, they would have made so much more of an impression if they would have taken their own money and done something with it to help the local community, to help education, whatever it was. They had a moment here to step up and really, really say, hey, we want to be part of the solution. We don't want to try to get over on loopholes.
Yeah. Is it just that small businesses are having problems figuring out getting through the red tape to be able to get this money? I was talking to Jim DeMint about this yesterday. He's with the Economic Revival Task Force, and he was saying that maybe he thinks it's because some of these bigger entities like the Ruth's Chris and the Potbelly, and that they have these attorneys. They know exactly the roads to go. They know how to get this cash from the Paycheck Protection Program. Could that be it? And then maybe, hopefully it wouldn't be too late to add some kind of protection against this happening again into this next infusion.
Well, Potbelly said they're not giving the money back. And here's the problem with a company like Potbelly. It's big when it comes to with respect to a mom and pop, someone operating a hair salon.
Mm-hmm.
But the company went public about in 2013, and it hasn't done anything. It opened at $30 a share, and it's now $7 a share. They've lost money for 4 years in a row. I mean, there's no doubt they need money, but there are facilities for them to go. There are ways as a publicly traded company for you to raise money. Listen, Dana, I'm in this. I have my own research firm for 30 years. We applied for money. I've done business with Citigroup for about 30 years. On the back of an envelope, just on a napkin, I would assume that my account is put through no less than $200 million in 30 years through Citibank. Well, they kicked my application to a bank with two offices. So I guess I wasn't big enough for them.
Dang.
And the bank with the two offices closed one of them because of the coronavirus. And they're talking to my COO, telling her, hey, you know, we're not getting instructions. So
wow.
We didn't get anything. We got zero, nothing. I mean, so I'm in this with these small business owners out there listening and who are frustrated. I know exactly how they feel. Like, you do business, these banks will take your money anytime you want to give it to them and charge you fees and do trading and do whatever they do with your money. But when you need something, you can't find them.
That's a great point.
The federal government, it's the conduit with these big banks that just turned their backs on. And listen, the community banks get high marks, very high marks. They have done an amazing job, but it's been these big banks that really have let us down.
Yeah, you make a great point. When they need it something from you, it's quite easy. I mean, the emails that they send, the links are all right there. I mean, heck, they make it as easy as possible. But when you need them, suddenly they forget how to handle technology and how to use all of the stuff to get that they used for you, how to reverse that and actually help you. That's a great point with that. Do you think that we're going to need after this? And I realize, you know, some of the answer to this is essentially, no, we just got to reopen the economy. But during that slow reopening, because I realize there's all these requirements, the grading criteria, et cetera, do you anticipate us needing another infusion into that Paycheck Protection Program? Or do you think that these guidelines that the administration has laid out, that we're going to be on our road to not having to need something like that?
No, we need more. Really do. It's really a shame. I mean, this is another frustrating part. Why are they piecemealing this? Because every time you need more, when it runs out, it becomes another round of horse trading. And you start to get things in there that have nothing to do with payroll protection. And pretty soon we'll have, things about just anything that has, just these agenda-driven things that have nothing to do with keeping the American economy alive, particularly small businesses. Honestly, they should have started with $1 trillion right out the gate. We've already seen trillions of dollars that have been earmarked from the Federal Reserve to prop up Wall Street. We've seen, other monies and other facilities that have been set up. So you talk about the engine of our economy, that where small businesses are the ones who hire folks. This is where dreams are created. This is one of the things that distinguishes America above every country in the world. So I'm just very frustrated that they would not have gone with a bigger number right out of the gate. We'll see what happens.
Yeah, that's a great point. Talking to Fox Business's Charles Payne. One last question for you here. Watching the instability with oil, and I made the remark earlier, I did appreciate that we all got a break from coronavirus expert Twitter and Facebook, so that now we have oil expert Twitter and Facebook, and all of the furor over futures and the deadline that was yesterday on May. Although I was reading for another piece where apparently they're still funneling money in towards June, so everything, to me, it indicates that everything's okay. We just have an overproduction, nowhere to put it. What effect is that going to have on this slow reopening of the economy?
I don't think it has an effect on the reopening, but the contracts, there are only three things you can do with them. You can actually say, I want you to send me oil to me, and there's no place to put it.
Right.
So, or you could sell it for a profit or a loss, or you could roll it over. But there must have been some folks out there who wanted it delivered or didn't want it roll over. Anyway, there was a glitch in the system. Someone lost a lot of money. I think it's more than anything else, if you broaden out the picture, it's just a reminder of what happens when you flip the switch and you completely shut down our economy. 69% of oil is used for transportation. We're using just a fraction of that to move goods, but not cars, obviously, not planes, obviously. But I don't think it's going to hurt the recovery. Cheap gasoline actually will be a pretty good thing once we get back on the road.
Woo, I know. Well, and that's going to be great, because I can imagine that the moment everyone can get back out for non-essential travel, everyone's going to get back out. No one's going to complain about being stuck in rush hour anymore. I'm so excited, Charles, about being able to get out of my house. I'm going to voluntarily go to the DMV. I'm going to go to the DMV. I'm going to swing by all the places that take forever. So excited. Can't wait to do it.
By the way, did you see in Denmark the haircuts? They allowed them to go out and get haircuts. They opened their economy last week. All the websites, all the sites went down for reservations. Everyone's trying to get a haircut. You're right. We're going to embrace life like never before. I can't wait.
It'll be great. Charles Payne, find him on Twitter @CBPayne. Charles, always a pleasure. We got to have you back again. Real treat having you. Thank you.